Welcome to the Thurston County Chambers Forum, Meet the Candidates. My name is Trenton Fletch. I am the president of Sunset Air and the chairman of the Chamber of Commerce. I want to thank you all for being here today. David kindly asked me not to plug Sunset Air today like I did at the last forum, so instead you can just go to sunsetair.com and read about our services and products. So, all right. I want to do a quick recognition of our ambassadors. Ambassadors, thank you for all your help, registration, greeting, collecting business cards. We appreciate all you do. If you could stand up and wave if you're an ambassador, we can give you a round of applause. Thank you, ambassadors. Also, we would like to thank Tags Awards and Specialties for their ambassador sponsorship. Thank you, Tags. Okay, now I'm going to draw your attention to a couple upcoming events. First is our annual Boss of the Year Award, which nominations are now open. This partnership with Express Employment Professionals recognizes outstanding bosses in our community. Nominations will be open Wednesday, October 11th, and finalists will be interviewed by St. Martin's University students, some of whom are here today. If you are here, could you wave? Woo! Thank you. Make sure to submit your nominations for an outstanding boss today at the Chamber's website. I see a couple of my employees back there, so I'm looking at you guys. All right. The Future of Work Summit, we will not be holding an October forum, but we'd like to instead invite you to join the Chamber at the Future of Work Summit happening Tuesday, October 24th at the Great Wolf Lodge. Businesses spanning the five-county area will receive tools to create a talent pipeline for the workforce, learn how to develop on-the-job training and apprenticeship programs, and make connections with other business leaders, community members, and educators to better understand and navigate the keys to building their workforce. Expo tables for this event are still available, and tickets are on sale now. See the Chamber's website for more details. Now I'd like to please bring up to the stage Cameron Barkus from Hometown Property Management as our forum sponsor. Cameron?
All right, well, hello, everybody. My name is Cameron Barkus. I am the new general manager of Hometown Property Management. Hometown is honored to be here to sponsor the candidate forum again this year. Thank you to Mr. Shafford and the Thurston County Chamber for providing a platform for candidates to introduce themselves and allow us to learn a little bit more about what ideas they have for bettering our community. Hometown Property Management is a full-service property management firm serving all of Thurston County and beyond. We offer both full and partial management services, as well as specialty services to fit any and all of your needs. We have been proudly serving in this community for over two decades and look forward to continuing to provide top-of-the-line management services for years to come. We here at Hometown take pride in our expert knowledge of the world of property management and have happily helped thousands of homeowners rent their homes without a worry, knowing that their assets and investments are in sound hands. We are continuing to grow our business in all aspects. As part of our services, Hometown is a licensed general contracting company that not only provides maintenance services to upkeep and maintain the conditions of the homes that we manage, but also are willing to and able to contract work within the community. Our biggest achievement, however, is knowing that we have helped countless individuals and families achieve safety and security in knowing that they are renting the best homes on the market from the best and highest skilled professionals in the industry, and I personally look forward to doing that for many years to come. Hometown Property Management has recently moved to Lacey. I would love to talk with any and all of you more after this to answer any questions you might have. You can get more information by visiting our website at hometownpm.com, giving us a call at 360-456-RENT, that's 360-456-7368, or just stopping by our new Lacey location located at 4804 Lacey Boulevard, Southeast. Again, I'm Cameron Barkus, and I'd like to thank you for allowing me to speak with you today.
Thank you very much, Cameron. Next, we want to bring up our today's program sponsor, Jonathan Plager from Morningside. Jonathan?
OK, Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to talk to you more about Morningside and how we can help your business. So if you're not familiar with Morningside, we're a nonprofit organization that helps individuals with disabilities find jobs in the community. So we work with businesses to match an individual's skills, interests, and abilities with the business needs. So like our tagline says, when everybody works, everybody wins. We just recently celebrated our 60th anniversary in June, and we're very, very proud of the impact that we've had on the community for those 60 years and the lives of the individuals that we support, but also on the greater community as a whole and to the businesses to help find talented labor in a market where there's still a labor shortage. But also, most importantly, to create a more inclusive community for where all people with all abilities can thrive. So with that in mind, I wanted to share a brief slideshow today to highlight the variety of businesses that we've worked with over the years and the diversity of jobs, the many different types of jobs that our clients, individuals with disabilities, have worked for those businesses. So let's take a look, and I'll talk a little bit more about that after the video. Thank you very much. Just to highlight a couple of those names there in my short time remaining, Bryson there at Home Depot, Tumwater for 8 years, he's worked there, Michaela at Hops and Drops for 2 years, Danica at State Farm for 9 years, one of their longest employees, Jennifer at Bath and Body Works, 10 years, plus she works at Hampton Inn and Suites for another year, Megan at Panowitz Jewelers, Sam at Home Depot on Phones Road, 7 years, Daniel in our Aberdeen office works at Safeway for 18 years. You saw his pin there. Allie at Lowe's on Martin Way, 19 years. Ginny at OB, saw Bruce there. We talked about that. She's been there 10 years. So since the last time you were there, Bruce, I think she was there. Jarrett at Marshall's for 8 years. Hannah at the Furs. So a diversity of jobs and lots of different things that they can do for your business. So please come talk to our staff and see how we can help your business to find dedicated, talented, loyal employees. Just talk to our staff at the booth or myself or check out our website. And one last thing, all of our services are free to the businesses we support. So thank you very much.
Great, thank you so much, Jonathan. Next, we want to bring up Joel Hansen from our Amoresco as our media sponsor. Joel.
Hi there. Thanks for having me. My name is Joel Hansen, and in 2016, at the age of 41, I became a father. And if you look into my eyes, you can see that I was terrified. And I had a lot of sleepless nights. And it wasn't because my son was a bad sleeper. In fact, he slept like a baby. But I was awake at night with thoughts running through my head like, when he's the age that I am now, it'll be 2057. And he's likely to live to see the year 2100. And I thought about wildfires and smoke and heat domes and drought and storms and floods. And I thought, if this is what we're seeing in 2016, what's the world going to be like for him in 40, 50, 60 years? About the time Fisher turned 3, I had another thought. And I realized there's going to come a day, maybe 4th grade, maybe 5th, when he's going to come home from school and he's going to say, Dad, guess what we learned about today? We learned about climate change. Have you heard of this? And I'm going to say, yeah, Fisher, I've heard of it. And the way this plays out in my head, the next words out of his mouth are going to be, what have you done about it? And I realized I've got just a handful of years to have a really, really, really good answer for my son. And so I decided to quit my job, leave my career, spend every day that I have left on this planet doing everything I can, everything that one human can possibly do to mitigate the harm my son experiences from climate change and your kids and your grandkids do. And I'm gonna do it by joining the clean energy industry. The only problem is, I don't know anything about clean energy. So the only job I could get in the clean energy industry was selling residential rooftop solar. And oh, by the way, this is right when a pandemic started. So it didn't take me long to realize I don't care about residential rooftop solar, and it's not because it's a bad thing. I have solar panels on my roof. If you have a roof, you should have solar panels on that roof too. But residential rooftop solar doesn't move the needle. It doesn't have the scale of impact that I had committed to having. I need to do big solar projects, big wind projects, big hydrogen projects, big fleet electrification projects. Well, who does this stuff? Who can I work for that does this? So I fire up the old Google machine and I decide I want to work for Ameresco, the number one energy services company in America, the number one clean energy integrator in the US of A. But I still don't know very much about energy and I'm not an engineer, so I'm going to have to convince them to hire me. And so they made me interview with four different people to get a job, from the regional manager all the way up to the executive vice president that runs everything in the Western United States and Europe. She's an impressive woman and has people reporting to her in London and Honolulu. Must make for really long days. And I decided to show them that I was serious, to show them that I really meant business. I'd take them back to a story from early in my career. 2001, I'm working for Morgan Stanley. I get sent to New York City for national sales training. One day the trainer comes in the room, he hands me a maze, kind of like this. He says, I want you to go from point A to point B without taking your pencil off the paper. So I dutifully go from point A to point B without taking my pencil off the paper. And he looks at me and he says, that's inside the box thinking. This is outside the box thinking. I told you to go from A to B. I didn't tell you to go through the maze. And as a 25-year-old kid in national sales training, right? So a couple years go by, I'm on a farm in Virginia with my good friend Joel Salatin, and we're talking about the world and life, and he says to me, Joel, the greatest challenge that humanity faces, the greatest threat to our very civilization, is a constipation of imagination. We just don't think big enough. And I realized that my friend Joel had let me in on a little secret there, and I'll let you in on it too. There is no box. There never was a box. The box is always in your head. And so I'm telling this to the people at Ameresco, and I say, if we want to solve the really big problems that we face, like remaking our electric grid, like remaking our workforce, like remaking our economy into something that is sustainable, we need that kind of thinking. We need there is no box kind of thinking. So it worked. They hired me. I started about a year ago in September. And 3 months into the job, they send me to the Tacoma Public School District to talk to their sustainability coordinator. And they've been a longtime client, so this should be a slam dunk. He wants to look at Mount Tacoma High School. And he wants to replace all the lights in Mount Tacoma High School with LEDs. And I take a lighting engineer, we walk through it, we do the tour, and then he turns to me and he says, this is great, but what about my other 69 buildings? And I'm like any salesman, I'm like, not a problem, what's your budget? We can bring that into the scope, expand the project, take care of it all at once. He said, that is a problem, I don't have a budget. And I've been doing my homework as a new employee at Ameresco, reading about projects we've done all over the world. And I remember a lighting project in Europe, and I said, well, have you ever considered lighting as a service? He says, what's that? I said, well, we could bring our capital to this project. We could replace every light fixture in the district, every school, every stadium, every parking lot. And we would own and maintain that equipment, and you would just pay us on a service contract, same way you lease the copier in the school office. And he said, that sounds great. I went to my boss. I said, hey, I think I got a live one. He said, that's great, Joel, but it's not legal in Washington State. In fact, I don't think it's legal in any state. I said, oh. But then I said, that doesn't make any sense. And I started calling people. And on December 23rd last year, I called our state representative, Beth Dolio, climate champion and author of the Clean Buildings Act, by the way. And she said the same thing as me. That doesn't make any sense. And she said, let's write a bill. I said, yeah, let's write a bill, Beth. And a lot of people told us we couldn't do it. A lot of people told us it would take years. The state treasurer tried to kill it. Several other people in state government did as well. But on May 4th of this year, my son got to help the governor sign that bill into law. And what this bill will do is massively increase the rate at which we address carbon emissions from our built environment in Washington State. One of the largest emitters of greenhouse gas is Washington State is buildings. It'll bring hundreds of millions, billions of dollars of investment into our state, private investment in public infrastructure. It'll create jobs in every corner of our state. So the reason why is there is no box thinking. because I'm committed to making a difference, and I dare you to try and stop me. This is the obligatory slide about Ameresco, where 60-plus offices in North America and Europe, 13,000 employees, most of them are engineers, I'm not, $13 billion in energy projects in the last 10 years, 8,000 clients around the globe. Last year, our projects accounted for roughly 15 million metric tons of greenhouse gas emissions avoided. That's about the equivalent of 36 billion vehicle miles not traveled. So if you have a climate mitigation plan you need to implement, if you have a greenhouse gas emission reduction goal you need to meet, if you have a fleet that needs a transition to electric or hydrogen, if you have buildings that aren't as efficient as they could be, or if you just think your utility bills are too damn high, come talk to us. We can help you. My colleague Kathleen is here with me. She actually is an engineer, a lot smarter than me. And we can help you figure it out, or we can call the people at Ameresco that can help you figure it out. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Thank you very much, Joel. And speaking of residential solar, that website again is www.sunsetair.com. All right. Next, I want to bring up David Shafford, President and CEO of the Chamber.
Thank you, David.
All right, throw me under the bus, will you? Who does Trenton work for? Sunset Air. Thank you, Trenton, with Sunset Air for being the chair and getting our meeting off to a start. Hey, before I jump into introducing the program and get the fun started, Trenton talked about the future of work. I'm sure everyone in this room has no problem finding the human capital and talent that they need, right? Guess what? The world has changed, and it's changing, and it's going to stay pretty much the same as far as the inability to find the talent you need. The Future of Work Summit is designed for employers so that you can understand new techniques, new opportunities, new relationship building, and develop different ways of filling your talent pipeline. So just think about, there's something in it for you when you show up and you look at the different workshops that are going to be there, the sponsors that are going to be there, and the resources that are going to be there. So just wanted to highlight that. You'll see more of it over this next month. You'll see a lot of it. So think about how you want to be prosperous in finding that talent pipeline. Well, again, David Shafford with the Thurston Chamber. So nice to be here today. So nice to see all of you in the room. This is one of our most engaging events of the year. The Meet the Candidates Forum, and it is truly a pleasure and honor for the Chamber to host such an event. It provides an opportunity for engagement of those running for elected office and leaders and business people within our community. We have featured races, or the featured program, which is the races for Thurston County Commission, District 4 and 5, featuring Vivian, Eason and Wayne Fournier, Terry Ballard, and Emily Clouse. And Port Commission District 4 and 5, featuring Rose Gundersen, Maggie Sanders, Troy Kirby, and Sarah Tonge. We have not had eight before to manage eight candidates up at a stage, so get ready. It should move fast and quick, and maybe there'll be some fun surprises as well. Before we move, though, to the races, we have a lot of people running for office in the room today, and I so much appreciate you being here. If those who are running for public office, not including these eight, if you would please stand, and we have two microphones coming, and they'll converge in the middle, so we'll start on the ends and converge in the middle, but we'll have you introduce yourself and the position you're running for, and again, welcome, and thank you for being here. So, Ashley, why don't you start?
Got it.
Yep.
Oh, and good. By the way, if you could look into the camera right here so people can see you when they're viewing you on the screen.
Yep.
There you go.
Good morning. I'm Andrea McGee, and I'm running for Tumwater City Council, position 7.
There you go.
I'm Frank DeRocher, running for Olympia School Board, position number 2.
I'm Veronica Shriver, running for North Thurston School Board, position number 1.
I am Alin Verbal, and I'm running for Yelm School Board, position number 3.
Michelle Gibson, running for North Thurston School Board, position number 5.
Vote for Leslie Van Lieshout for Olympia School Board, number 4.
Spencer Zeman, Lacey City Council, position 2.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Ashley Lee Brooks, and I'm running to retain my seat as Yelm City Councilor, position number 6.
Go, Ashley!
Hi, everyone. I'm Kelly Von Holtz, and I'm running for Tumwater City Council, position number 7.
Hello, I'm Jasmine Vasavada. I'm running for position 1, Port of Olympia, jasmineforport.com. Thanks.
Hi, Bill McGregor, running for Port of Olympia Commissioner, District Number 1, and remember, experience matters.
Talana Reed, I am the current School Board Director of District 2 for the Olympia School Board, and I'm running for District 1 for the Olympia School Board right now.
My name is Esperanza Badillo Diorio, and I'm running for North Thurston Public Schools Board Position Number 4.
I'm Stephanie Scott, and I'm also running for NTPS position 4 because I learned too late that SB and I share a similar platform, and so I've actually suspended my campaign to support her, but unfortunately couldn't remove my name from the ballot. So please vote for SB over Stephanie.
Good afternoon. My name is Gretchen Maliska, and I'm up for re-election for North Thurston Public Schools in District 1.
Excuse me. I'm David Ross, as in rossforolympia.com. I'm running for Olympia Mayor, as in rossforolympia.com.
All right, my name is Nick Dunning. I am running for Lacey City Council position 3, and I do not see my opponent, Ed Kunkel, here, so I'm pretty sure by chamber rules I have everyone's endorsement. So thank you for that in advance.
Nice. All right. Did we miss anyone? Don't be shy. If you're running for office, you can't be shy. All right. Hey, on behalf of the entire community and the chamber, thank you, those running for office. It is, you are providing a sacrifice, we know, to your life, and you're giving for a higher calling of serving community and being in leadership position, and it is truly appreciated. So thank you. So with that, let's move on to the program and our moderator, facilitator, Doug Ma, director of the Chamber's Public Policy Division. Doug, the program's yours.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. You're supposed to say, good afternoon, Doug.
Good afternoon.
All right. So this I have to tell you, as a recovering former elected official, this is the best time of year, right? Campaigns, debates, moderating, this is gonna be so much fun, right?
Yeah.
Right, because this is the most important thing we do, we participate and we vote. And you've heard me say this over and over again, public policy is made by those that participate and show up. The easiest way you can show up is by voting in November, okay? So this is all really important stuff, and we're gonna have some fun today. So we're gonna go a little bit past 1 o'clock. As you can see, we're gonna have 8 candidates here, so a lot of stuff to work through. So today's featured races are for county and port commissioner. The Thurston County Chamber of Commerce was an early supporter and advocate for expanding the commissions from 3 to 5 districts. 3 to 5. So last year, voters approved this expansion at the chamber's urging. So that is why we are featuring today the 2 new districts that were created this last year. District number 4, which is essentially the rural part of the county, and District 5, which is essentially kind of, if you squint a little, it's kind of the Lacey-ish part of the county as well, right? So the county is divided into 5 unique districts. In the primary, it's kind of in a nomination election, and then everyone gets to vote in the general election for all these positions. So there are no incumbents in these 4 races because the positions didn't exist last year, right? So that's why this is really important. It is also important to note that there is another race, Port Commission District 1, where there is no incumbent. And so we're gonna have Jasmine and Bill stand up. You two stand up. Stand. They are also running for Port Commission. So, now you can sit down. Yep. So joining us today, and we can have the candidates start coming there forward and taking their seats. Do not change your seat or it messes up my script. So District 4, we have County Commission District 4, Vivian and Wayne running for a one-year unexpired term, and then Emily and Terry are running for a three-year unexpired term. And then also joining us for the Port Commission District 4, we have Rose and Maggie. And then District 5, we have Sarah and Troy. Now, in the new districts 4 and 5 for the Port, this is kind of interesting. It's just a weird little thing. The commissioner-elect with the most votes in the general election serves a four-year term. The winner in the other district that gets the second most votes will only serve a two-year term. District 1, Bill and Jasmine, they're running for a full four-year term. So as we transition to get everybody in sync, that's why we have this kind of weird staggered stuff. So just real quick, just kind of ground us some more. According to the Thurston County Auditor's webpage, county commissioners, those on my left here, candidates, county commissioners serve as the local government and legislative authority outside of city limits. The commission oversees county policies, approves the county budget, and manages other duties as directed by the state legislature. Now, commissioners on my right, the Port of Olympia is a municipal corporation governed by five elected commissioners who set policies and objectives. The commissioners appoint the port's executive director, who is responsible for the ongoing management of the port enterprises and facilities. So just out of curiosity, if you think you live in District 4, please stand up. Nobody lives in District. If you think you live in District 4, which is the rural part, if you live in Tenino, you live in District 4. Okay, stay standing. If you think, stay standing, District 4, stay standing. If you think you live in District 5, stand up. Kind of Lacey-ish, right? If you live in Thurston County and you are a resident and registered to vote, please stand. So for candidates, this is really important. These are your constituents. They will be voting for you. And it's really important. You all get to vote for any one of these candidates on the stage. It's really important. It's confusing because we do this by district, blah, 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 blah. Okay, so I want to point out our timekeeper. This is really important because we have limited time and we have a lot of you, and I know you want me to not be talking so much. So Alicia there has two cards. One says 15 seconds, the other says time. Time means stop talking. It's going to be really critical that we stick to this. There are going to be some questions that you get 90 seconds. There are going to be some questions where you get 60 seconds. And there's going to be, at the end, 30 seconds. It's really important that we do this, and we all be really respectful here. So we will move on. So everyone understand the important position there? Everyone can see? Okay, I know, they're all really tense because this is like this big buildup. So just a round of applause for our candidates here. Oh my God. So we will do opening remarks, 1 minute each. We will move from my left to my right, which means we'll start with Vivian, followed by Wayne, followed by Emily, followed by Terry. So, timekeeper, ready? 1 minute on the clock. Vivian, your 1 minute opening remark, please. Oh, you have a microphone? Oh. You should use the microphone.
I should use the microphone. Thank you, Doug. Microphone.
You have to share microphones, too. So okay. That's just another little trick here. Don't club each other with the microphones.
Okay. First, thank you for being here today. It's very important that you know who's running and you know a lot about us. So I've lived in Washington State since 75, Thurston County since 87. I worked for Thurston County over the years for 35 years, the last 15 with emergency management. I've worked in the community extensively for those 15 years. And I go to county commissioner meetings, I go to a lot of land use meetings, I go to a lot of meetings, so I know what's going on in the county. I'm very involved. And I really care about the people of Thurston County. And I'm also endorsed by the two big unions of the county, the Sheriff's Office Union and the 618 Union with AFSCME, because we also have a a crisis for staffing. And so I really care about people that serve you, and so let's just make a difference in Thurston County.
Thank you, Vivian. Wayne, your 1 minute opening remark, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be in front of you again. My name is Wayne Fournier. I'm currently the mayor for the city of Tenino. I've served there for over 10 years. And we've talked about some of the successes in Tenino. We now have the opportunity to have a new district, and that is in Southwest Thurston County. I, like you all, have fought hard for five commissioners, and I think it's now time to evolve the county government. And it's important to have somebody that has experience in government sitting there helping guide that. And I believe I'm that person. In addition to being the mayor, I've worked as a professional firefighter for the last 25 years. I'm a graduate from Washington State University with a degree in philosophy, and I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
Thank you, Wayne. Emily, your 1 minute opening remark, please.
Thank you. I'm really happy to be here with all of you constituents today. I'm your neighbor. I'm a U.S. Army veteran, and I'm a state employee. I'm also the founder of a nonprofit organization called CARE, which supports justice-involved youth and families for successful reintegration into the community. I champion fiscal transparency, and I pledge to foster unity across all jurisdictions within Thurston County. I plan on prioritizing affordability when it comes to housing. On the front of public safety, I'd like to prioritize collaborative opportunities for restorative justice and addressing the root causes of crime. Facing climate change, it's mandatory, it's very important for us to implement the Thurston Climate Mitigation Plan effectively. I see the challenges our county is facing as an opportunity to reassess priorities, build partnerships, and find innovative solutions with long-term benefits to our residents, our environment, and our economy. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Emily. So, Terry, your opening 1 minute remark, please.
My name is Terry Ballard. I live in Tangawild. I'm a combat veteran. I'm a senior leader of 22 years in the military. I retired on active duty as a U.S. Army Master Sergeant after 35 years. And retired in 2012. I have real world experiences in finance, logistics, facility management, transportation, and maintenance. I'm a U.S. Army trained equal opportunity representative. I serve as a volunteer veteran service officer who staffs, sponsors, and helps write bills for the state of Washington for veterans. I know and understand the frustrations of county land use and policies and permitting. I'm an old-fashioned Democrat. I call myself a JFK and ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. Thank you.
Thank you. Up next, we'll start with Rose, followed by Maggie, followed by Sarah, followed by Troy. So Rose, your 1 minute opening remark, please.
Thank you. I grew up in Hong Kong where I admired US democracy since I was a teenager. So when two prominent non-political leaders asked me to run for the board because of my proven experience in combating human trafficking, supporting small businesses, I embraced that opportunity. My three kids grew up here. They left because of the lack of opportunity here. I understand the need to invest in education and growing job opportunities so that we can keep our local talents. My vision is to make Thurston County the destination for high-paying jobs, healthy food sourcing, and exceptional living standards here. Many local leaders recognize my proven leadership. They've endorsed me, they supported me, labor unions and business groups. So I'm committed to giving my best, not my own agenda, by listening to bring the best solutions for the people of Thurston County so we can keep our talents here locally. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Maggie, your 1 minute opening remark, please.
Hello, my name is Maggie Sanders, and I have been living in Washington my entire life. I was born into the fabric of democracy. My grandfather was the original signer of the Macaw Constitution. So it has been instilled in me the civic responsibilities to community. And I would like to be the community's collective voice in moving the port out of the 20th century into the 21st century. It is important to me to look at the diversifying the economy and balancing the budget. Fiscal accountability and responsibility, transparency, and I have been an environmental champion for over the last decade. I've served regionally and nationally on air quality applied sciences, and I'm a NASA ambassador and have experience as a human resource director and employment rights director. I believe that there needs to be a transition into clean energy and green energy, and that by supporting our local economy.
Thank you, Maggie. Up next, Sarah, your 1 minute opening remark, please.
Yes, thank you all for being here today. It's important we all participate in the process. So my name's Sarah Tonge. I'm an IT professional. I am currently a technical support supervisor for a company called HungerUsh, leading a team, managing projects, just helping get things done for our company. But the reason I want to get involved in the port, Joel explained it better than I ever could. When we look at these kids and the future they're facing, the reckoning that they have to come to about the climate, it's not fair to make decisions that aren't going to be looking far into the future for them and doing everything we can to have a sustainable planet. So that's why I'm here. But I think my technology experience and collaboration, project management skills will help me collaborate with the current commission and just help build a better Port of Olympia for all the citizens and all the people.
Great. Thank you, Sarah. And then finally, Troy, your 1 minute opening remark, please.
Hi, my name is Troy Kirby. I need your help in protecting the port. The economy is interconnected. So if we tug on one thing, we're going to tug out another. And the idea that 5,000 jobs that are connected to that port, especially union living wage jobs, will not have an effect on the rest of our economy, including our nonprofits who will not get fed from donations when other jobs go away, is just not something that I want to be a part of. It's not part of Thurston County values. I respect the environment. I have the Department of Ecology's staff union endorsement. I've had the endorsements of others. I think that it's really important, though, to understand that if you want to clean up Butt Inlet only gets cleaned up if there is a marine terminal down there, because there is no way the state and Fed are going to commit $100 to $200 million on cleanup if they don't think that there is a purpose beyond just cleaning up the water. That's not how things work. I want to protect union living wage jobs in this community. Please help me.
Great, thank you. So I'm going to ask, let's not try to applaud at the end of each statement. So we're going to try to speed things up here a little bit here. This is what I like to call the quickfire questions. These are intended to be one-word answers. So for example, I'm going to say something like, you know, gee, Doug, pick one, Apple or Android, and I'd go Apple, right? Okay, so we'll start with Wayne, followed by Vivian. Coffee, tea, or neither? Wayne.
All the above.
Vivian, coffee, tea, or neither?
Coffee.
Great. Terry, followed by Emily. Coffee, tea, or neither?
Coffee.
Coffee.
Coffee. Emily?
Coffee.
Coffee, okay. Maggie, coffee, tea, or neither?
Coffee.
Rose, coffee, tea, or neither?
Coffee.
Coffee. Troy, coffee, tea, or neither?
Coffee.
And Sarah?
Coffee. Coffee.
Tea. Coffee. All right, now we know where we're all going to be meeting afterwards for early morning meetings. So let's go into a little bit more detail. We'll start with Troy, followed by Sarah. Again, same sort of thing. Facebook, LinkedIn, or Twitter?
Twitter.
Sarah, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Twitter?
LinkedIn.
Maggie, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Twitter?
LinkedIn.
Rose?
Facebook.
Facebook. Terry, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Twitter?
Facebook.
Emily?
LinkedIn.
Wayne, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Twitter?
Facebook.
And Vivian?
Facebook.
Great. Wasn't that informative? I thought it would be informative. Okay, so we'll make it a little bit tougher now. Again, a single word, you're supposed to complete the sentence. We'll start, I'm all messed up here. So we'll start with Vivian, followed by Wayne. This sentence is, my favorite place in Thurston County is blank. What's the blank? What's your favorite place in Thurston County? Vivian. Favorite place in Thurston County is?
The forest on my horse.
Great. Wayne, favorite place in Thurston County is?
Tenino.
Emily, favorite place in Thurston County?
Pump track downtown.
Great. Terry, favorite place in Thurston County?
Lawrence Lake.
Great. Rose, your favorite place in Thurston County?
The port waterfront.
Maggie, your favorite place in Thurston County?
Billy Frank Jr. Refuge.
Thank you. Sarah, your favorite place in Thurston County?
Tomie State Park.
And Troy, your favorite place in Thurston County?
Tumwater Falls.
All right. So that was kind of fun. Let's try another one. So I'd like you to pick your spirit animal from one of these two choices. The invasive New Zealand mud snail or the endangered Mazama pocket gopher. So Sarah, pick your spirit animal from one of those two, mud snail or pocket gopher?
Pocket gopher, I guess.
Troy?
Neither.
Oh, man. Rose, mud snail or pocket gopher?
Mud snail.
Maggie, mud snail or pocket gopher?
Pocket gopher.
All right. Emily, pocket gopher or mud snail?
I like bulldogs.
Bulldogs. Terry, mud snail or pocket gopher?
Mud snail.
Vivian?
Cute little pocket gopher.
Pocket gopher. And Wayne, mud snail or pocket gopher?
You can only find one in Tenino, and that would be the pocket gopher.
I really like that one because, you know, one is invasive and the other was endangered. So, you know, it's kind of fun. Okay, so that was all cute. So we'll get ready for some more detailed, specific questions. This next one, for some reason, we'll start with Wayne, go to Vivian. We'll just go down that way again. But the question is, will you be voting to increase the local sales tax by 0.2% for public safety? Yes, no, maybe.
Yeah, I'm actually on the steering committee for the yes vote.
Thank you. Vivian, yes, no, or maybe?
Yes, definitely. I worked for the Sheriff's Department for a long time.
Terry, yes, no, or maybe on the 0.2% sales tax increase for public safety?
Yes.
Emily, yes, no, or maybe?
No.
No. Maggie, yes, no, or maybe on 0.2% sales tax increase for public safety?
Yes.
Rose?
Yes.
Troy?
Because of Derek, yes.
And Sarah?
Yes.
Great. Quickfire, wasn't that fun? Okay, yeah, they're going, what's you gonna ask next? Okay, so one of the things that I did this year is I asked each candidate in 6 words or less, what is the single most pressing challenge facing the commission? So I'm gonna ask if you agree or disagree with your opponent's response. And then why or why not, you have 90 seconds to respond. So as an example, we'll use Maggie followed by Rose here to start us off. So Maggie, Rose responded that the single most pressing challenge facing the port commissioners is rebuild trust, leadership, and deliver value. 90 seconds, do you agree or disagree with your opponent's response? Why or why not?
Yes, I agree with Rose. I feel that there has been a disconnect with the Port of Olympia's education and outreach and working collectively with the community, and that they've recently really invested in a POCAC, which provides the community opportunity to have a collective voice in decision making. And so they really made strategic planning and efforts to support and build that trust back up within the community, and they've been really amazing at including the community and their voice in decision making. And so I believe that it's an ongoing effort, and that it needs to continue forward as we move along with the process in regards to a collective voice of the community to be able to provide input on business decisions that impact the next 10 generations. And I feel it's extremely important to have that connection with community.
Great, thank you. So Rose, Maggie responded that the single most pressing challenge facing the port commissioners is $100 million to clean up Bud Inlet. Do you agree or disagree with your opponent's response? Why or why not?
I do agree that it's a very important project, and it is challenging, but it's going to take collaborative efforts. As Maggie said, as long as we are collaborating, as long as we are telling the stories of what the port delivers for the people, we can get this accomplished and get it done. There have been many examples of such cleanup efforts around the state, and they have been very successful. There's no reason we cannot do it. People of Thurston County are strong, collaborative, and it takes leadership who can mobilize people to get it done. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So Troy, Sarah responded in her six words that the single most pressing challenge facing the Port Commission is balancing environmental stewardship with economic growth. Do you agree with her? Why or why not?
Well, sure. I mean, I agree with the idea that we do need to make sure that we protect the environment. I mean, I saw climate change this last December down at my store, downtown Olympia. I get to watch it wash over the roadway. We have to worry about that type of stuff in rising sea level. But that doesn't also mean that we negate the jobs that we have or the economy. And that's why that's a balance. That's why those things exist. We don't just say, hey, one size fits all, but one size dominates the other. That's not how things work. And it's not a Thurston County value to ignore the environment either.
Great, thank you. So Sarah, Troy wrote in his single most pressing challenge facing the commissioners, protecting union living wage jobs. Do you agree or disagree? Why or why not?
Yes, I completely agree that protecting jobs is very important. While it's maybe not the single most pressing issue with climate change coming, protecting these jobs is very important. And we're not going to be able to tackle climate change by taking people's jobs and not affording them a living wage to make their livelihood. We're not. So I propose different out-of-the-box solutions that are not akin to the marine terminal that we have now. While we can continue forward with that for the time being and, you know, keep those jobs and utilize what we can there, we need to pivot and see what else we can do in this century with using technology. Thurston County Port of Olympia is the largest landowner in Thurston County, so we have this land available to utilize for other purposes. It doesn't have to be all about this marine terminal, but I completely agree. Jobs are so important, and that is the mission of the port, to drive economic development. So of course jobs are gonna come with that.
Great, thank you. So on this side, we'll start with Terry, followed by Emily. So Terry, Emily wrote that the single most pressing challenge facing the Thurston County commissioners is ensuring dignified housing and health solutions. Do you agree with her? Yes or no, and why or why not?
I agree with her in part, but it's all about financials. If you do not have the money, you do not, if you have overtaxed, over-regulated, you get overburdened, therefore you don't have the money to spend on the economy, you do not have the money to spend on the businesses, and therefore it revolves around one another, so I agree in part. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Emily, Terry responded to the question with the following. Financial accountability with informed decisions. Do you agree or disagree? Why or why not?
Can you read his statement one more time, please?
Yes. So when asked, what is the single most pressing challenge facing the Thurston County Commissioners? Terry responded, financial accountability with informed decisions.
Yeah, I definitely agree. Fiscal transparency is paramount. It's one of the top priorities when I am in the seat of County Commissioner. I definitely believe we need to prioritize fiscal responsibility. However, I think that means putting funds where the community will benefit the most. So we need to ensure that we are funding public health and social services. We need to ensure that we are funding proper and appropriate economic development. We also need to ensure that the people of Thurston County feel safe. So in terms of fiscal transparency, I think that the number one thing we need to do is listen to the voices of the community members who are living in the experiences that encompass the challenges we're trying to overcome.
Great, thank you. So Wayne, Vivian responded that the single most pressing challenge facing the commissioners is expensive, complicated, and overregulated building permits. Do you agree or disagree? Why or why not?
Expensive?
Expensive, complicated, and overregulated building permits.
That's a challenge. Is that the single most important challenge? I don't know if I could say that. When we're on the cusp of reforming our entire government, essentially, we need to be thinking about out in the future, 10, 20, 30 years, reforming our permitting process and making sure that we can afford housing. That's an immediate issue that we need to work on, and it's pressing. It's driving up housing prices everywhere. It's driving people out of homes, and that is a very, very important issue. But as a county commissioner, you need to be thinking out into the future. And right now, we're reformatting the whole form of government, and that's a 100-year problem. So that is, I think, where we need to be looking out way out in the future.
Great, thank you. So Vivian, Wayne responded to the question, how do we modernize county government? Do you agree or disagree with your opponent's response? Why or why not? His response, what is the single most pressing challenge facing the commissioners? How do we modernize county government?
Well, the county government,
I think it was off.
Okay.
but the county is working on that now. They're looking at modernizing the way you get your permits, doing it online, a lot of new website, new systems in the county. I believe the county is continually looking at developing and growing forward in their IT. So I believe that is, it's not the single most important thing in the county, because the county's been doing that for many years. But I do believe that it's really critical, and they've done a lot to allow people to watch meetings online and to be able to record. So I think the county is already moving forward that way. It is very expensive. It takes a lot of work, and it also takes a lot of infrastructure outside just the county too. So it takes a teamwork of working with businesses and with the cities even. It would be nice if we all worked together and did some more just combined forces a lot. Like we were looked at a years back at doing a law enforcement system that everybody would talk to each other, and just making something that we're looking at more regionally as we're working toward our goals in technology. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So something really exciting is gonna happen next month, October 12th. Your voter's pamphlet statement will arrive in the mail. Ooh. So, 60 seconds to respond. Your pamphlet is going to arrive, and each candidate submits a statement to be included in the voter's pamphlet. So I went through it, and I have some questions about what you wrote and submitted as part of your voter's pamphlet statement. So we'll start with Terry, followed by Emily. You don't know what I'm going to ask. So Terry, you wrote, when elected, we will continue by voting to benefit the citizens of our county and by representing them over Thurston County's staff influence. Terry, who is we, and what are the examples of staff influence? 60 seconds, go.
We are those that who show up and stand up at the county meetings. I've been doing that for the last 12 years. Also, there's a couple statements of RCWs. A statement of one, what one does not know to be true is a false statement. That's a gross misdemeanor. What another one says, a public officer making false statements, okay? That's another RCW, okay? What we need is we need to make informed decisions on the correct data handed to us. We're not all experts, and our staff are supposedly the experts, and we need to create a balance between the public and staff, basically on the public side, not just the staff. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So Emily, you wrote in your voter's pamphlet statement, quote, the pillars of our county's future, unity, transparency, and commitment to justice, shouldn't be compromised. Examples of the future being compromised at the county?
An example of the future being compromised at the county would consist of voices in the community going unheard. It would consist of, people. We have groups of people mobilizing in our community to try and vocalize their concerns to the county commissioners, and they feel like their voices are going unheard. So unity, transparency, and all of those things that I write about my voters pamphlet statement, they all really align with what the community needs. And we have to start with talking to those people who are living through the experiences, and I'll keep harping on that throughout this entire forum. We really, really need to have community voices at the forefront of our policies and the implementation of those policies.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
So Wayne, you wrote, "If elected, I will make sure that all voices in Thurston County are heard. Examples of all voices not being heard?"
I think the greatest example is the change from 3 to 5. As the mayor of Tenino, I felt like South Thurston County has been somewhat unheard. When everybody raised, this is the Thurston County Chamber. This isn't the Lacey Chamber, Olympia Chamber. But when Doug asked people to stand up, there were very few people from the 4th District that stood up. So for us to have a seat at the table, it's been hard. And so there has been a feeling of disenfranchisement from the rural community. And I think it's important that now we'll have somebody that comes from that community and is already a representative in that community. I think that's important as well, that we'll be able to be a voice at the table, because if you're not sitting at the table, you're on the menu a lot of times. So, you know, I really believe that that's important, and I look forward to being that person.
Great. Thank you, Wayne. So, Vivian, you wrote, "Above all, I'll be upfront about what's hindering our potential and strive to mitigate counterproductive and self-serving political fights between the two major political parties." Do you have examples of self-serving fights at the county?
Boxing matches. No. I believe that, to be honest with you, I think that the county commissioner position should be nonpartisan, like the city councils are. So that's what I was thinking of there. Is I'm running as an independent. I would like to see that we can work toward what is best for our community, not what our party wants. And I find a lot of times that's what's being done. And so that is what I was talking about with that, was making sure that, and like my opponent said, is South Thurston County, my work mostly in the county was with the unincorporated Thurston counties. They do feel very unheard. And a lot of times they are a different culture than what may be in the city, because they're, most of them are, they are farmers, or they maybe even commute a long ways just to get into Olympia. It takes me 45 minutes to get to Lacey. So it's a little different. So I wanted to make sure that everyone has a voice and that we listen to everyone.
Thank you. So Troy, you wrote, quote, "Diplomacy is about no one feeling that they got 100% of what they wanted, but no one feels that they lost out completely. Please elaborate on diplomacy as it applies to the port."
I think we've listened to a small minority that complains a lot of times. And I think that the majority that actually find benefit from the port haven't spoke up enough. I think it's good that we actually weigh the decisions based off of the fact that it is an entire group, and not everybody is gonna go away happy. In fact, no one always goes away happy in diplomacy, because you have to work at hard decisions. But the reason you do the hard thing and the right thing is because they're often the same thing. And that's my viewpoint on it, is that if you don't try to make sure that everybody feels at least they got some input, then nobody got really anything except for a small minority that whined.
Great, thank you. So Sarah, you wrote, "Through my education and professional experience, I have gained a solid foundation and deep understanding of the Port of Olympia and how technology can improve operations. Please elaborate on your solid foundation and deep understanding and how this applies to the port."
Yes, thank you. So I got my start here at a local internet company, Reach One Internet, over here in Lacey. They were bought out by a bigger company in Tacoma. But I believe that the experience I gained there, learning all about broadband, local ISPs, and how they operate, will enable me to help bring broadband service and expand at the Port of Olympia, which is going to be a big service and help increase education and opportunities all along the pathway of the broadband.
Great, thank you. So Maggie, you wrote in your voter's pamphlet statement, "I have effectively worked on core issues that impact the lives of our region's residents, all while prioritizing being a change agent in diversity, equity, and inclusion to protect our most vulnerable communities. Please provide examples of core issues you've worked on."
Throughout my public service, I've worked in natural resources, and I worked regionally and nationally on national policy in regards to air quality and human health security. And I went through training through NASA to be able to access satellite data in regards to environmental justice. And so I bring a unique lens of a lot of years of public service and climate change, and I feel that people that are impacted the most are the most diverse folks that are impacted in our region. But that, so that's one of my major priorities is environmental stewardship and bringing that to the Port of Olympia and looking at all types of policies and policy development to include our underserved populations that are mostly impacted. And that includes diversity, equity, and inclusion. And I support that very much.
Thank you. So Rose, you wrote, my cultural and multi-sector professional experiences have shaped my ability to establish trust and collaborate with diverse groups. I have a proven track record of bridging divides, working across the aisle, and passing legislation that helps people. Please provide examples of your track record.
Thank you. 10 years ago, I was the policy intern at the Attorney General's Office on Human Trafficking. Through that, I developed multiple proposals and distributed to the legislature and worked in a bipartisan manner to get them passed. And because of that, our state now is rated the best of human trafficking law in the whole nation. That was in 2013 when we got that accreditation. I have nonprofit, government, supporting small business, and now I work for the Washington Retail Association as the Vice President of Operations and Retail Services. My executive experience and management experience tells you that I don't need to know all the subject matter. I have the executive ability to listen and make the best decision by listening and consider all perspectives. That's what a commission does, is the governing experience, not the technical background. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So this has been kind of boring with me asking all the questions, and now is the much anticipated fun time where the candidates have an opportunity to ask a question of their opponent. You will have 30 seconds to ask your question, and then your opponent will have a minute to respond, and then we'll reverse that and do the same thing. So we're going to start with Sarah and Troy, and then move to Rose and Maggie. So Sarah, do you have a question for Troy?
Troy, I was just wondering what your vision for the port is in your perfect world. What would you like to see out there?
Troy, 1 minute.
What I'd like to see is that we actually engage with subcommittees for, you know, really with the HR director. We take part of that $15 million surplus, we put $400,000 and $500,000, and we actually build that out per quarter to where it is not supplanted by the new executive director or the current executive director. And we work on recruitment. We work on the actual idea of building up our employees. We make sure that the port is a pipeline of success. And that pipeline of success actually gets the Port of Seattle and Port of Tacoma trying to poach our workers, but we get the best and brightest who actually want to stay. We need to create dynamic solutions for this in a culture that people want to be here. If you want to go to a professional development environment, we want to help you. We want to drag you on that pipeline of success because that helps everybody in that environment. And living wage union jobs means that you are part of that pipeline, and that's where it goes. And that is where I see the port's vision as it moves into 2050 or 2021.
Thank you, Troy. So, Troy, do you have a question for Sarah?
Tell me more about your IT experience.
Yes, definitely. So, like I said, I started at that ISP, so managing a team there, learning all about the co-location, and we worked with Grays Harbor PUD and their broadband systems. From there, I moved to a point-of-sale retailer where I traveled nationally, training on how to use the product, learned a lot there. And then currently, with my current position, I help support restaurant technical services. So really, whatever a restaurant would have in their point of sale, in their business, what they need to do their operations. And how that's going to help the port is all the greater management experience, along with, like I said, some interrelated things like broadband and worker training, but also my project management experience, my leadership experience, my reasoning experience, and collaboration experience are all valuable things that I'm going to bring, not just technical leadership.
Great, thank you. So Rose, do you have a question for Maggie?
Yes, hi Maggie. If you were elected, what would be the headline for the port in the first year and the last year of your term? The news about the port.
I believe that the headline would be in regards to the Bud Inlet cleanup. They've been making a lot of progress regarding driving collaboration and working with local government, federal government, and state government and the local municipalities to the cleanup is $100 million, and it's going to take a lot of collaboration and partnership. And so I believe that it's going to be shown the successful work of the commission is going to be proven by our collaborative partnerships with our local municipalities, federal and state level government, and that we will provide a successful cleanup.
Great, thank you. And Maggie, do you have a question for Rose?
The port received $7 million in taxes from the citizens, yet the budget experienced deficits every year. How will you balance the budget without levying more taxes to the citizens of Thurston County?
Rose, 60 seconds.
I have managed overseeing finance staff for a number of years. I know how to get that done. What's most important to tell the people is that the port only to invest in education and workforce, our school district exact 30% more tax than the port. That's what you need to know. And yet, we want to invest in both education and economic development. The port has a big role in that, and the narrative about the port getting too much tax is not true, because the schools get 30% more, at least in the Tamora school. So I want to tell the truth about the fact that the port is able to balance the budget. The port is doing the right thing to do economic development. They are doing a good job. More could be done, more trust could be built, more value could be delivered. Thank you.
So and going to my left, Emily, do you have a question for Terry?
Yes, I do. So our regional housing council has developed a homeless crisis response plan, which is a 5-year plan. Whoever is in the seat of District 5 for our county commissioner will serve a 3-year term, meaning they will be part of the new homeless crisis response plan when it's developed. So Terry, how would you promote health and safety of our unhoused neighbors in developing this next plan?
Terry, 60 seconds.
Our unhealthy neighbors need to... The homeless is a problem. Drug addiction is a major problem. Over 80% of the homeless have a drug addiction. Next 4% have a mental illness. We need to combat those through programs, viable programs that work. And as far as something being said, something being planned, we need to get off the planning. We need to implement everything. 5536 was a bill that was just passed that clarified drug addiction, illegal drug use, and illegal drug possession. There is a plan for that. Get counseling, but we do not have the funding package yet to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. So, do you have a question for Emily, Terry?
I believe in incarceration. I believe in people being responsible for their actions. I believe that that they should be responsible for actions. Currently, current county commissioners canceled 119 outstanding warrants. We have other people that show up and step up to their responsibility. Would you continue to cancel 119 outstanding warrants, and which will have
Emily,
no
your
responsibility?
Please. 60 seconds. Go.
Sorry, can I ask Terry a clarifying question, or should I just respond to what he said?
I would just respond to what he said.
Okay, no problem. So I do not believe in mass incarceration as a solution to handling human behavior. The people who are affected the most by incarceration are those that are the closest to poverty. So we know that we need to address the root causes of crime. We need to address, you know, positive workforce development opportunities for those who are underserved in our community. We need to promote mental health services, adequate mental health and substance use services. It's so hard in this community to get access to those services. I work with youth in the justice system through my nonprofit that I founded and I'm the executive director of, and I see this every day. I talk to these youth every single day. They really need consistency and they need us to show up and provide opportunities for reintegration into our community that does not involve mass incarceration.
Thank you, Emily. So Vivian, do you have a question for Wayne?
I do. So currently the county commissioners meetings are at 2 p.m. in the afternoon on Tuesdays, and then their public hearings are usually about 3:30 in the afternoon. And the open houses are also held during work times in the city of Olympia. How would you better schedule and work toward inclusiveness for our unincorporated Thurston County folks that they're mostly the ones being impacted by the decisions been made by the county commissioners? How would
you do that? Thank you. Wayne, your answer to Vivian, 60 seconds.
So the question is, how would we get our information out better? I think we've made a lot of inroads with technology. We all were doing Zoom meetings during the pandemic. And so utilizing those technologies. And then the first step is having a representative that lives in that district and holding town halls, being available, going to the various community events that are down there and representing the people with boots on the ground.
Great, thank you. So Wayne, do you have a question for Vivian?
Let me try to think. So last election, you were very supportive and endorsed congressional candidate Joe Kent in the 3rd District. He's been in the media lately a lot for seemingly agreeing with policy, I'll quote it, shutting the border down for 20 years to stop demographic replacement. Do you plan on endorsing him and supporting him again?
Great, Vivian, 60 seconds.
Honestly, I didn't endorse anyone last year. I may have been a lot of places with him. I was in parades and such, but as a candidate running last year, I didn't endorse anyone, and I don't plan to endorse anyone this year. And I'm actually, I look at people by what I believe about their there's some new people running this year, and so I'm really interested in seeing how that's going to change the dynamics of the congressional district. And so I did not endorse anyone last year, and so I don't know what that question's about. Thanks.
Great, thank you. Whew. A round of applause. Those were some tough questions. So we'll wrap things up. We're gonna start on my far right and move our way back this way. Closing comment, make it persuasive, go.
Hi, my name is Troy Kirby. I'm running for District 5 for Port Commissioner, and I need your help in protecting the port. I'm an entrepreneur in this community. I've been an instructor at the School of Business here at St. Martin's. I understand what it takes, and I think it's important to look at the nuances that actually come from an interconnected economy. You pull one string, it's going to pull off the entire shirt. The idea that we can just get rid of some of the things like the marine terminal or reduce some of the airport or hold off on some of the real estate holdings, they're going to cost us long term.
Sarah, your 30-second closing remark, persuasive remark, go.
Yes. So I believe in big out-of-the-box thinking at Port of Olympia. We don't need to shut down what we have without replacing and moving forward with what we can build. They have so much. We have so much land in public hands and these taxpayer funds going into the economic vehicle of the port. We can both balance the environmental needs and plan for the future while also driving economic growth. We have the resources. We just need to think and have the vision.
Great. Thank you, Maggie. Thank you, Sarah. Maggie, your 30-second closing remark.
Yes, as your port commissioner, I would bring environmental stewardship, fiscal responsibility and accountability and transparency in government and bringing about a democratic accountability. I'd like to bring the port to the 21st century, and with your collective voice, we can get there. It is important to me that all people represented in the port be in community. I'd like to support our local agriculture, food hubs, climate, wind, energy, microgridding.
Thank you, Maggie. So Rose, your 30-second closing remark, please.
I want you to consider my track record that is a proven leader. This is what a prominent leader locally says about me. When Gundersen cast a vision, she accomplished by being strategic and collaborative. This is a nonpartisan position. We need someone who's bilingual, bicultural, meaning someone who has the ability to understand different perspectives and arrive at the best solution. That's who I am. Please tell people about me, roseforport.com. Thank you.
Thank you. So Terry, your 30-second persuasive closing comments or remarks? Terry.
I am hopeful.
Oops, sorry. Start again.
I am hopeful for your vote and endorsement in this campaign, which will place one of us running in a position to make positive decisions which will serve the interests of the people, property owners, tenants, businesses, and those merely passing through the county, and will continue to make Thurston County a better place to live. I appreciate your vote in the general election.
Great.
In advance. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Emily, your 30-second persuasive closing remark.
Thank you. I'd just like to thank the Thurston County Chamber for this experience and this opportunity to share our visions with the community. I'd also like to thank all of you, the community members, for engaging with electoral politics in our community and your willingness to be informed. My journey started on the streets of this county, from being in the county, serving our country, managing family small businesses, and starting a nonprofit here in the community. My dedication to Thurston County makes me uniquely equipped to serve. I ask for your trust and your vote.
Thank you, Emily.
Thank you.
Wayne, your 30-second closing remark.
Again, thank you all for letting me come before you today. In life, love, and business, you're defined a lot by the people you surround yourself with. If you look at my pamphlet, I'm endorsed by nearly every elected official in Thurston County. If you want to hire a plumber, you hire a plumber that has experience plumbing. If you want to hire a politician, you want to find one that's got some experience doing that as well.
Thank you. And Vivian, your 30-second closing remark, please.
Thank you all for being here, and I look forward to you voting for me. I am a 35-year experienced person working in the county. I know the county systems. I also spent 31 years in the Army Reserves as a civil affairs specialist. I retired as a master sergeant, and I'm a veteran. And I have worked for nonprofits, or I volunteer for nonprofits currently, and I just enjoy serving the people of Thurston County, and thank you.
Great, thank you. A round of applause for our great candidates. So remember, public policy is made by those that participate and show up. It's important that we show up at the ballot box. Please use the information you've gained today to make an informed decision, and remember to vote in November's general election. Thank you. Trenton.
Oh, yeah, you guys should leave, or are you going to be?